What's in bloom for the month of June? Stay tuned to find out. Hi, welcome to Attainable Green. I'm Jess, and today I'm going to share with you my blooms and a couple of orchid updates for the month of June. And there are some really exciting things I want to share with you, so I can't wait to get started. So first of all, I want to share with you my Laelia Zip is finally in bloom. And not only that, I have two plants to share and they look so different. So the Laelia Zip is a primary hybrid between the Laelia tenebrosa and the Laelia milleri. When you cross these two plants together, you usually get a nice blend or hybrid of the characteristics of both parents. So in this case, we have a very interesting dynamic. I picked up two of these plants because I wanted to see how a different parentage can affect the plant growth habit and even the flowers. And you can definitely see it in these two plants. So the first one is the first one that actually bloomed. This one is the smaller and more compact of the two Laelia Zips. As you can see, it looks a little bit more like the milleria. It has a great bright red coloration, that star-shaped flower look, and that tubular lip. This plant is almost so bright, it's kind of hard to capture it. So I had to take a video of it in the sunlight to kind of capture more of what it looks like. The plant overall is a lot smaller and compact compared to the average Cattleya. I would say it's more like a medium size or a standard size. And this is its first real bloom. Right now, it only has one flower, but it actually came out with three buds. Unfortunately, it got eaten by slugs, and so I had to protect it and keep it away. And so only one was actually able to have a beautiful flower. So the next zip is the size that I typically see, and it's larger. It looks more like the tenebrosa parent, and you can tell because it has these huge flowers that have kind of this bronzy brown coloration, and it still has that tubular lip. As you can see, the petals and sepals are not as reflexed, so it gives a better shape, but it doesn't have the same coloration. So it's very interesting to compare flower shape and flower color and that presentation. And it turns out that I like both of them. So I'm really interested to see how these ones both mature and how it'll look in the future. As you can see, snails did get to one of the flowers. That's why it looks chewed on. It's missing parts of the petals and sepals here. And even part of the lip is missing. So that's something that I had to struggle with. This is the first time this plant has bloomed, so obviously there's a little bit of wonkiness. Some things are not completely symmetrical, so hopefully it'll work out the kinks and it'll just look even better the second time around. Now the next plant is the Miltoniopsis Breathless Hilo Galaxy. Now this one is one of my favorite Miltoniopsis because it's just an unusual, stunning plant. It has kind of this cosmic look throughout the petals and the sepals. It kind of has like a splash patterning throughout the entire flower, and that is quite unusual. Usually you would see that waterfall pattern only on the lip, but I see it throughout the entire flower, and that's what makes it unique. It's very compact, it's on the smaller side, and this year it only gave two flowers. I think that's because I let this plant dry out a little too much, so I know for next year I gotta bump up the waterings. The next plant is the Encyclia phoenicea. Now this species is a beautiful, stunning plant, and it's my first time growing Encyclias, and I am already in love. So I grow this one fairly bright, and as you can see, the leaves have that anthocyanin kicking in, so it has pretty much purple leaves at this point because it's in bright, bright sun. Not only that, but the flower spike is huge. It's fairly tall, almost over 3 feet high, and it has about 12 flowers on it with a few that are just opening up now, and there's definitely more to come. I'm really loving the brown purple coloration of the flowers. It just gives it a really unique look, and not only that, it has a beautiful fragrance. It smells like cocoa. Some people call it kind of like the milk chocolate plant, very similar to the Sherry Baby, but I find that the Sherry Baby smells a little bit sweeter and this one smells a little bit more powdery. So it's almost like if you opened up a hot chocolate packet with that powdered inside and you sniffed it, it gives it that kind of scent. It's very pleasant and it's very light, and I think that's something that makes it really desirable. I grow this plant outdoors with my Cattleyas, and it can definitely handle all the light, and it needs a lot of water, more water than I give my normal Cattleyas, so I have it potted up in a small bark mix. Overall, I'm really excited about these Encyclias, and hopefully I can grow more of them in the future. Now the next plant is a NOID, and this is a Zygopetalum. This plant was considered a rescue for the longest time. In fact, it was my very first Zygo that I got about 4 years ago, and it's finally in bloom after 3 years. And that is a huge achievement because I struggled a lot taking care of this plant, figuring out how it grows, and finally, it's stable enough and secure enough that it decided to shoot up one flower. Granted, it still has a long way before it becomes a beautiful mature plant, but it's definitely on its way. Now, the next plant is a NOID Phal, and it's ID'd as the Taisuco Jasper. Now, this plant I have been struggling with for the past year. Originally, it's been really easy to take care of, but lately, I think the media started to degrade. I had to repot it. Then it threw out a spike, I broke it. So I threw out the second one, and it's not as big as it usually is, but it's still stunning nonetheless. The flowers are a little bit smaller, the coloration is a little bit different. It's really interesting to see how environmental factors can change the presentation of the flowers and the coloration of it. I think it's been a lot warmer than it has been in years past, so I think the flower color of these plants is a little bit washed out compared to what it usually looks like. But either way, it's still stunning, I still have it, and I think if I just work out the kinks, then I can make sure that this is a more reliable bloomer in the future. Now, the next plant is actually not in bloom, but it's really interesting because this is the Nervilia tanguensis, and this is my first foray into terrestrial orchids. So this plant has a really unique growth habit where it starts off as a tuber. Once it breaks dormancy, it shoots up a flower spike. After this flower spike fades, then it grows a single heart-shaped leaf. In this case, I wasn't able to capture the flower spike. It grew, but it didn't seem to last very long, and I don't think flowers actually developed. I think my conditions weren't ideal for that. This plant usually likes really high, humid conditions, perfect for a terrarium, and I didn't have that. So the next best thing was to put a sandwich bag over it, and hopefully that would be enough. And it did work, except that it caught on the leaf, and so it caused a little tear in the leaf, and that's why it looks the way it does. But other than that, it's been working great. I'm really loving the coloration of the leaf. It's really unique. It's kind of purplish, reddish toned, and in the light it kind of glistens. So I'm really enjoying that. And right now it's a really interesting point in its growth stage because it's going to be sending out these runners, and that way it's going to burrow back into the media, and it'll create tubers for next year. And then the leaf itself will die back in the summertime, and then the season and the cycle will begin again. So this terrestrial plant has been really interesting for me to grow, and I am loving it. Not only that, I'm also loving the live sphagnum moss that has been able to come alive in this setup. So I'm hoping to be able to maintain that in the future. So those are the plants that were in bloom for the month of June. And going into July, there are a couple more that I'm really excited about and I can't wait to share. So a lot of changes are going on this month and next month. Currently, I am downsizing my collection, so there is going to be a couple of changes of what's going to happen, how many plants I have, all that stuff. It's pretty much up in the air, and I'm trying to figure out what is that final number that I'm looking for. Another thing is I have started flasking orchid seeds. I did my first round last month, and coming soon, I'll give more information about how that's going, and I'm going to do another round later in July. It's really interesting and exciting because I thought flasking orchid seeds would be very daunting, that you really need like a huge clean room and all that stuff to really get good viable seeds and no contamination. But it turns out it's not as hard and as difficult as it may seem. I think there's a lot to learn and there's a huge learning curve, but I'm excited to see where it goes. So the last thing I'm working on is building up a local native garden here in my home. So here in Southern California, I've been struggling to grow some ornamentals and vegetables and things like that in my front patio and my side yard and all these other places. And I decided that I would just stop fighting my environment and learn to live with it. So this year I'm trying to create a butterfly pollinator garden. I'll explain more of that in a future video, but it's gonna be really exciting to see those things happen. And And hopefully I'll have more success because these plants are adapted to the California climate as opposed to any other location. So that is all I have to say for today. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next episode. Bye.